Neptune and Uranus. At first glimpse, the seventh planet from the Sun emerges as an unmeasurable globe of green-blue fog. Slip below the icy veil of Uranus, and you find a world apparently without end, because this is a planet made almost wholly of gas. Hydrogen, helium, and a sprinkle of methane that gives the planet its color. It is challenging to explain to people what it feels like, the interior of these gas giant planets, because it is so far from our terrestrial existence. The third largest planet has at least 13 rings, though unlike the broad bands of Saturn, these are thin and dark. No one is sure how they formed, but they could result from collisions within a small army of at least 37 moons. Uranus's has a prominent feature, its crooked tilt. It is the only planet in the solar system to revolve on its side, resembling a colossal bullseye. How did it end up this way? The explanation may surprise you, and Neptune and Uranus influence astronomers because we know so little about these planets. We have hardly ever had one spacecraft visit them, and it was a noticeably short flyby. The most exciting thing about Uranus is that it has wholly tilted over on its side. Its atmosphere shifts radically depending on the period, and it has an interesting thin ring system. Furthermore, these, of course, are some rings. It is an accurate picture of Uranus, and although divided by 1.6 billion miles, one of the world's largest telescopes is watching the planet spring into life. Uranus has been going through a great season that we call equinox. The north polar part, getting into the sunlight for the first time in 2 decades, is applied to all kinds of dynamic cloud action, none of which was expected or foretold. So it is exciting to get this data and be revising textbooks about the Uranus system. Right now, we have inspired astronomers. For the first time, this far-flung outpost is being viewed in a different light, and when it develops into an image, it is not a moment too soon. That is because for most of us, Uranus is the butt of a big cosmic joke. I'm saying Uranus because I believe people are embarrassed by Uranus. Uranus. Yeah, I pronounce the planet's name Uranus, which is likely closer to the initial intonation of the name of the god after it was designated. If you think Uranus is a funny name for a planet, you may favor its first name, George, observed by William Herschel in 1781. He christens his new find George Cetus after the King of England, George III. The practice of naming planets from ancient mythicist prevails, and planet George is no longer. Furthermore, Uranus would be expected to have remained nothing more than a green-blue blotch at the end of a telescope if it was not for a bright rocket investigator and a little luck. As an intern at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory in California, Stephen Hogan investigates a journey to the outer planets. He began drawing images of the solar system. He could almost picture a ruler between Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune. Furthermore, in that process, he noticed that all the outer planets turned out to be about the exact alignment relative to the Earth in the late 70s. Pluto was not helping, but that is not a worry. Furthermore, many characters said back in the 60s that it would be impracticable for us to ever explore those far-flung planets too far away. This mathematical sleuth work exhibits a rare window where the planets are flawlessly arranged for a visit. An opportunity ever used 176 years for a single spacecraft to fly by all 4 giant planets. That was 1977, and so we designed the Voyager mission to begin on that journey. A complex package of Voyager experiments takes the first close-up look at the enormous Hagenbach. In an exceptional feat of engineering, teams build 2 rockets in just 12 years and drive the existing global network of ground sites to new heights. The external solar system's called outer for a reason. It is a long way away. The rest of the solar system beyond the asteroid area is really where it is at. Thus, that is what the Voyager did. Voyager revealed to us what existed out there. On board, there is even a gold record containing a greeting from Earth should the shuttle encounter any benevolent aliens. Hello from the descendants of planet Earth to launder you anew. To review, all Salados et al. We identified the Voyagers would be the first to reach interstellar space. We felt that this was a publication from Earth that we could instantly send a message continuously from our solar system into orbit about the heart of our galaxy. Launched a few weeks alone in 1977, the twin Voyager spacecraft started on their epic journeys associated as the Grand Tour. It was a first. It was historical. Just being part of the entire mission, being a member of this colossal enterprise, the first time in human history we see these bodies up close, it was a thrill. What would it be like to follow Voyager's tracks, to endure one of the most unbelievable journeys in space exploration? Sending a robot to the ice giants is one element that sending human billions of measures across the expanse of space is entirely different. Getting to the ice giants is tough. Any journey to the external solar system would occur hereabouts on the launch pad. One launch is one of the most dangerous conditions for every mission. You will also need a spacecraft. This is the prospect of space travel. The Orion is a mock-up of the Orion cockpit. Thus, we will launch the vehicle and discuss what it is like to take off and get into space. Rocket to the ice giants blasts off. We have presently lifted off, and we have freed the tower now. And right now, I would be strapped on my back. Nestled in tight in the jeans would build upon me. To me, it felt like someone was resting on your chest. It took me back to staying on the playground and having the bully lying on your chest and beating you up. I mean, that is what it seemed like. You are on your way to Uranus and Neptune, following in the wake of Voyager. It will take us about 8.5 minutes to get into space. You can see we are growing higher in altitude. The sky is getting fainter. What will a 24-year Uranus mission be like? What will you observe? What will you do? Furthermore, how will you regularly endure? Coming up, I am proposing a vacation to Uranus. Time to consider what you are about to get into. 63 times larger than the Earth here, you would be fortunate to mark a single birthday. The planet takes 84 years to make its way around the Sun. Uranus and sister Neptune are recognized as the ice giants because of their icy outer atmospheres, super cooled to minus 355 degrees Fahrenheit. The most essential, most noticeable feature about Uranus is its crazy tilt. However, it was not forever this way. The conventional explanation was that while Uranus was growing, it may have been hit by a more critical chunk of accreting material than average and hit it over on its side. The dilemma is that when you do the math on this, it does not operate. It is challenging to get a comprehensive enough body traveling fast enough to be very convincing at knocking Uranus over on its head. Rather than being hit, it is now thought that Uranus must have been swept off its feet by the gravitational tugs of its enormous neighbors. Uranus has tilted issues in somewhat complex interactions with Saturn, Neptune, and Jupiter. Even in these planets, which have gravitational forces on one another. Furthermore, the forces are more exact than we used to think. Furthermore, its dynamics are not a big hit in the face from a sizable affecting planet. Testable. Assume if Earth were like this, turned on its side. Equatorial jungles would convert to ice, or in summer, the Arctic Circle would dissipate. Furthermore, mature into a steaming tropical paradise. What would be north? What would be south? You could get into exceptionally long, passionate discussions at a bar with astrophysicists about where the North Pole of Uranus is, so don't go there. If turning the Earth creates weather chaos, what is it like on Uranus? Do the clouds rotate on the corresponding axis at its tilt, or abnormally? scientists have many inquiries about the original ice giant. When Voyager journeys to the external solar system in the 1970s, it transmits back astounding images of Jupiter, Saturn, and many of their moons. The wonderful thing regarding the Voyager mission, we saw so various things for the first time, and they moved all so different, so diverse, and distinctive. When the images are coming in, staying there makes you feel that you are the bridge of the Starship Enterprise, because you feel you are there. Those are your sensor protection, and you are getting stories back from these alien worlds that you're getting a look at. Who could ever have complete pictures of Saturn rings? So, what do Voyager's cameras expose of Uranus? The irregular planet, or Uranus, was a real puzzle, so we did not know what to expect in the 1986 era after a decade of moving through space. There are great expectations for the seventh planet from the Sun. From the Earth, it resembled kind of bland and honest. From Voyager, look sort of planned to the pictures of Uranus, where we are a bit frustrating. It is a very bland planet, with very few clouds. Not much was going on at Uranus. These are the first pictures of Uranus obtained from Voyager 2. The planet looks as still as a pond, with no cloud feature at all, and it is silent. We did not detect a whisper from Uranus before the Uranus encounter, unlike Jupiter, whose magnetic field reverberates across the radio streams. At first, Uranus does not give a peep. Part of this was because of the radio origin that was on the opposite side of the planet, where the strong magnetic fields are, and they have directed away from the spacecraft. Then Voyager detects that Uranus's magnetic field is wildly off-kilter. You have one hemisphere with potent magnetic fields, sturdier than the Earth's magnetic field. You have a different hemisphere, the one pointed towards the Sun, with weak magnetic fields. Planetary magnetic fields require the passage of charged particles on Earth. This happens in our molten iron core. So what is pushing Uranus is a magnetic field. There is much more performing on here than meets the eye. Just what rests below Uranus's veil of vapors? To find out means freeing your calendar for the next 24 years and enduring a flight from hell. You have avoided the clutch of Earth's gravity, the first step on your journey to the outer solar system. NASA has been working on its recycling systems. It may not satisfy everyone's taste. We use wastewater streams from a variety of origins. We take hygiene water from our showers, cleaning our hands, brushing our teeth, urine of course, and then we take several processes to make that wastewater clean enough that we can drink it repeatedly. The clean water tastes like the water you would purchase in the grocery store. It is still, so it does not taste as good as the water from your tap because there are no minerals in it. It does not taste like wastewater, like, you know, whatever it came from, so with your thirst quenched, you are on your route. Sit back and relax for the next 10 years. So you have survived the decade-long mission to Uranus. Hopefully, you have not put on excessive many pounds from the 10,000-plus in-flight meals. Time to search your own. From orbit, Uranus gives a few away. Fall below its placid-looking clouds. Furthermore, you find a world that anything but. So let us imagine I was traveling an atmospheric probe sent down into the planet of Uranus. Open your spacecraft window here, and you will immediately feel where the ice giants get their name in the upper atmosphere. Frozen crystals of methane combined with hydrogen helium. We might pass some of these towering anvil vapors that we know are there, and as we stared at those, we would look for the thunderbolt. We would listen for the thunder that follows them. Free-falling here is like descending into a giant green gelato. The deeper you go, the thicker and warmer the atmosphere. Temperatures warm up to thousands of degrees. The leftover of when the planet formed eventually. That stress builds and the gas converts to fluid or a liquid, and there is no natural transition. It is just a continuous increase in pressure and density. Keep falling, and you will soon work to boil in a boundless sea over 2,000 times deeper than the Pacific Ocean. Somewhere down here, a little more than midway to the planet's center, Uranus is irregular. Magnetic field flutters into life. If you could see underneath the dynamo core's exterior, where the field is created, you might see the particles of liquid walking about, and they are usually so conductive that those particles of liquid would move field lines with them. Why the magnetic field is created here and not in the core, no one knows. No person or robot has ever stayed down here. If we could get even far away, we might get to a center, but we are uncertain. Isn't that fascinating? We're not sure if you're in have a core. Down hereabouts, one point is sure. With a planet load of water and gas on your back and in temperatures of greater than 40 to 100 degrees Fahrenheit, no life or android would last long. There would be no possibility of preserving under those circumstances. A probe advancing into the atmosphere would ultimately disappear and become part of its studying environment. Not enthused about the possibility of being smashed and cooked alive by a ball of gas? Don't worry. There is, however, possibly more to see and do. Cruise over the skies of Uranus and take a pic of your 37 moons, most identified after characters from Shakespeare. If I were to take a visitor trip to the Uranus system, everyone would agree to Miranda. Only 290 miles across, Moon Miranda is about as broad as the state of New York. But the geography here is stranger than anything on Earth. It is an exciting sort of jigsaw puzzle moon. It looks like a potter has put it together without spending too much thought on his materials. It has pieces of this and chunks of that that sort of look like they're stuck together. Furthermore, freely, we still do not know Miranda too well. When Voyager first finds Miranda, no one is sure what to do with it. Then when the pictures came back of Miranda, Miranda's initial ideas were shattered by an enormous impact, broke up and came back collectively. Now scientists think the moon may be found in the heart of a cosmic makeover. In the initial stages of a satellite's history, the satellite is changing. The rocky bits fall to the center, and the icy orbits are of lower density and moving outward. Thus, maybe that is what we are witnessing. Miranda was suspended in a state of differentiation. As a result, a part completed lunar development zone with some remarkable sights to attend. Miranda's got some spectacular ice rocks on it that you could sit on top of and look down for 5 or 6 kilometers. I think the Grand Canyon is incredible. On Miranda, these cliffs are at least 3 times higher. If you were to jump from it because of the exceptionally low gravitation of Miranda, it would take minutes to gently fall to the surface, with this lovely blue fuzzy ball of Uranus in the backdrop. It might even be picturesque. Moreover, while you're on here, it is troublesome to ignore your Uranus tourist attraction. It is a collection of 13 razor-thin rings, and Uranus's mean rings are tightly defined with enough space in separating them, sort of like a set of hula hoops, frequently large hula hoops flying away from Uranus. No one is entirely sure whereby these rings appear, but they could result from a cosmic demolition derby. The 5 essential satellites of Uranus are in somewhat regular orbits and are enduring. Some of the additional objects, particularly external satellites of Uranus, scientists have been operating on computer models that show they do frequently collide. Furthermore, if they get too near to Uranus, they could burst apart, and of course, Uranus produces an extraordinarily complex family of rings that we think are broken up satellites for the planet. That has forever been the butt of everyone's joke. So conceivably, it is only just that it holds the last laugh. This is because Uranus is the best view on its rear end. As we were flying out from Uranus, we watched back and gazed at the rings that we call high Phi's Engelhertz equivalent of if you have a dirty windshield and you drive toward the afternoon sun, the dust bits light up. So likewise in the Uranus system, I remember lying there because the picture got down, you know, line by line and worked out, and just the comfort that, oh my goodness, we did not understand there was something spectacular to see there at Uranus. so take a tremendous last look, as there is nothing added to see for 3 more years, till you reach Neptune. Being cooped up in a tin can is undoubtedly going to play tricks on your mind out in space, separated by such great distances. It would help if you began thinking about the science of space conditions. You're going to be in a tight, confined environment with virtually no privacy. Going out from Uranus is its sister Neptune, another enigmatic ball of freezing gas. Furthermore, out here, there is evidence that the solar system still has a few ridiculous tricks up its sleeve. You can now be managing. On the approach to Neptune, be planned for a surprise attack on each side, because at the end of the solar system, as a remembrance of home, a secondary blue planet. Unlike Uranus, Neptune was instantly beautiful, mainly when we produced color images, because it had a blue-green atmosphere and those white clouds hovering in the climate. So you could not help, at least I could not help, but be recalled of Earth at 30 times the Earth's distance to the Sun, and the star appears not much more than a glimmering point of light. Out here, the days pass swiftly, each 16 hours long, but you will need a packed calendar with around 90,000 days to a Neptunium year. That is 165 Earth years to orbit the Sun. Like its neighbor, Neptune is an enormous ball of hydrogen and helium, and it is the color indulgence of a bit of methane. It is so blue here that some additional chemical compound is at work. Furthermore, we do not know whatever that is yet. It is the irregularity that we are trying to answer by studying Neptune. There is something in the clouds of Neptune that is making its vivid blue color. With our telescopes on the ground and in space, there is less scattering in the environment. There is a more profound methane layer, so even more red is consumed from the atmosphere, making Neptune a blue planet rather than a green planet. Besides, that is not the only secret, and something is driving Neptune's wild winds, the most active in the solar system. Furthermore, why do Neptune's spots disappear nearly as quickly as they arrive? Most important of all, Moon Triton has a mystery that all the experts questioning. So as we were progressing Neptune and getting more widespread and more significant in the TV screens in the Voyager project area, that got us going rapidly. We saw Neptune had some various things that Uranus did not, which was a rough spot in its atmosphere. Voyager saw various spots, one of the most prominent ones we imaginatively called the Great Dark Spot. It was kind of like seeing a blob of ink in whirling water about the size of Earth. The excellent dark spot is an enormous hole, a window to the darker clouds below. So it was a writhing storm that cleared out a hole in the clouds, allowing us to see falling to more profound layers. However, it did not give the impression of being solid. It gave the impression that any movement, it could come apart. Thus, we were not all that shocked when in 5 years, it had vanished. In 1994, when NASA turned Hubble, its encircling telescope, its great dark spot had disappeared towards Neptune. So this planet develops its spots. Leopards do not, but Neptune does. It dramatically transforms its spots on timescales of merely 5 years. That was a shock that Neptune shifts so quickly. It is a different planet. Since then, other sports have come and gone. No one is sure why, but it could have to do with Neptune's wild equatorial winds. Spring into Neptune's atmosphere, and you will surf the most energetic atmospheres in the solar system. Winds howl around the equator at almost twice the speed of sound. This wind tunnel in Los Angeles is hardly a ripple of air than Neptune's wind, because in the outermost planet in the solar system, what forces the weather is that there are two factors. One is the sun. Like the Earth, all the sun is relatively weak. And Neptune and later Neptune have some excess heat, and the heat grows out as hot gas when the planets form. All this matter came crashing together, and that crashing collectively produces heat. Furthermore, some of that energy is still there, embedded down inside Neptune. When the warmth inside Neptune comes out, you get updrafts, forcing the jet currents. The whole body is a dominant weather machine. With no large land mass to stop them, Neptune's jet currents keep going and going. It could imply that the winds on Neptune just accumulated. Instead, they advanced over time to be relatively rapid, even though the power that caused them was fragile. What is under cover of Neptune's ferocious winds? Does the planet that gets its name from the god of the sea live up to its name? Can you cruise on a Neptunian sea? Just around everything about Neptune and its arrangement links to water. One thing most specialists agree on is that Neptune has loads of water. However, precisely what form it takes is less optimistic. Nevertheless, it is something almost everyone has an opinion on. There is much water on the matter, but it is down below, and it is seemingly too humid to be a liquid right now. Down here, it is like dipping in a planet-sized fog room. Gas is compressed into a liquid, not an ocean, but a strange mixture of atmosphere heavily laden with denser and denser fluid materials as the pressure got more powerful. If there were a sea on Neptune there, it would be quite far inside the planet. It would not be on the outer part of the planet, where we may put a shuttle or a boat like here on Earth. The mixture of heat and water is necessary for life to exist. You've got heat, you've got hydrocarbons, you've got water. You could rightly have gained some life form somehow. I presume it will not be exceedingly complex, but who knows? Maybe the real colossal stingrays were floating around deep in the ocean. Not a fan of the dark? Do not worry, like its icy friend, there are loads more sea to do without getting your spacesuit damp. Those engaged in rings got taunted mercilessly, as we neared Neptune because it was not apparent Neptune held rings per se. When we got there, Neptune had diffusive rings, complete rings, and these moderately opaque ring arcs. Neptune's rings may not be the most attractive in the solar system, but they are yet worth a picture or two. Neptune's rings are clumpy. Some segments are dazzling and very thin. These particles are very dark. They might be water ice mixed with some organics, or maybe just organic material. They only reflect a few percent of the light that they collect, so very dark, very distinct from Saturn's bright, icy rings. It has occurred that these ganglia comets are kept in line by the gravity of miniature satellites, known as shepherd moons. This was something I was individually involved in, and trying to learn how the arcs were there. Furthermore, we discovered that they were tied by one moon that Voyager's moons had in the ring section. As a ring scientist, I would be inquisitive about collecting some keepsake ring particles, so I would presumably try and, you know, get a space where the jet ski equivalent, and next go to explore the rings of Neptune. Neptune's comets are one of a kind in the solar system. The real showstopper here is Neptune's moon, Triton. Just going to Neptune means putting your career on hold for 24 years. That is a lot of in-flight movies, but what if you could put your living on ice? Delayed animation has long been a popular topic of science fiction. Like the patients of this cryogenic department in Arizona, this space explorer of the future could well become a space-time traveler. The purpose is to keep them in a position of suspended animation until they can become resuscitated. Inside these canisters are frozen remains of 88 people, all wishing for a second shot at life. The dilemma with cryogenic suspension is that it is not very user-friendly. Die first, but this could all turn for the space Voyager of the future. So you could put them in a position of delayed animation, put them on a spaceship, and months or years later, wake them up at the target so they would not need to be alive and knowing and to eat and doing all the extra things that you have to do when you are lively. Already, scientists are acting on ways to reduce metabolism. About 2 hours after introducing AMPE, and the rodents now are in a profound hypothermic state. The mice who rarely hibernate are imbued with a nucleotide that hinders thermoregulation. A state of hypothermia is then provoked by lowering their core heat. They are sluggish at first, but ultimately uninjured. I hope to run any of this in a human test somewhere down the path within 10 years. Could this be the fate of space travel if we offer incredible journeys to planets like Neptune? Suspended animation may be the complete solution, but will a trip out here be deserving of the time and the fuss? Well, some planetary scientists deem it could be so if we visited Triton. Well, I cherish the night we flew over Triton. We lingered all night because I believe the flyby occurred early in the morning, and it was just so amazing. Triton is an overly complex moon we experience only in part. The largest of Neptune's 13 known moons, Triton is wrapped in a thin layer of ice, its exterior ripple and feel with traits seen nowhere else. Triton has pits on the portion of its surface, called the cantaloupe region, because it looks a lot like the outside of a cantaloupe. The other impressive thing about Triton is that it has a drastic past. Neptune almost unquestionably caught it. The reason we stayed positive that it was caught is that it is revolving. It is going around Neptune in the opposite direction. Furthermore, hiding in these fuzzy pixels is Triton's unique party trick of all. Voyager's camera catches geysers that blast high into the air. It was observed that streams were coming off the polar cap of Triton, and those things were running some 15 kilometers or 10 miles into the air, and then catching a 90-degree turn as they knocked a standard jet in this fragile environment. We are not sure if the internal heat engine of Triton influences these plumes, or they are powered by the tiny and faraway sun, which might produce some local distillation to make these plumes. These are Triton's icy volcanoes that excrete an inky cocktail into the gleaming exterior. When we see black stuff in the outer solar system, we think organic material. Organic does not mean life or plants alive. Our talk suggests carbon-bearing. These are the construction blocks of life. So we believe that the dark matter may be prebiotic chemistry operating on not life itself, but the ancestor to life. So here, we encounter even our last port of call, Triton, cold, cold body. There is the motion is going on. So you eventually made it to the exterior solar system, following the historical journey of Voyager 2, after 12 years of flying. What do you do on a quick stop before spinning around and going back home? If I were moving to the outer solar system, going to Uranus first, I would want to orbit Uranus a few times to take in the rings because I hold that, you know, rings are one of the countless fascinating sights in the solar system. Then I would go picnicking on Triton, and I would make sure that I bought some hot clothes with me and some binoculars, because resting on Triton and looking at this gorgeous blue Neptune hovering up there would be quite a trip. Furthermore, later, I am sure I would be sit idling for Old Faithful to go off long that was going on to take by staring at the other planets in our solar system. We could hear about planetary arrangements. Furthermore, I hold that Uranus and Neptune have stories to tell us, only to hear their stories. They are the ice giants of the solar system, to fathomless realms, impossibly distant and unimaginably unfriendly. Uranus, the planet with a curious name, but with concealed beauty. And Neptune, a seemingly watery world with a spouting moon. It is extraordinary that humans will attempt out here soon. However, until we do, who knows what other secrets await discovery in the ice? That is the virtue of visiting the solar system. It is full of astonishments.